Right, so let's speak with a security consultant, fraud and security consultant, Richard Kumado, who has a fair understanding of exactly what's happening. Mr. Kumado, thank you very much. It's an honor to have you. Hello, Mr. Kumado, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Great. I said that it's an honor to have you. Now, I want to assess what's happening with one, compliance, and two, enforcement of the lockdown ban from the security perspective. So let's start from your own assessment of how you think day two has gone so far. Today is day three.
I think it's a level of adaptability. This is new to so many people. And from both ends, from security to the citizens, we will need to be flexible enough to be able to adapt and apply to the times we are in. And to that extent, I want to say to the security agencies, let's be a little bit more circumspect and be a little bit more professional in handling the citizens. But so far, so good.
I spoke with the Police Public Relations Directorate, and they tell me that by their assessment, overall, compliance has been good, but I am concerned that irrespective of the views of the police hierarchy and the military hierarchy, that compliance has been good. We have seen a number of videos and social media evidence circulating which suggests some form of brutality from the military and police hierarchy about this. The military, of course, have come out to say that most of these videos are fake, but I am concerned that individuals could put out such videos. You get the sense that they're trying to make the military and police very unpopular in a very unpopular situation like coronavirus environment.
Yeah, very true. Very much true. I was very worried and I was concerned. I to speak to the National Security lawyer and National Security Law Advisor to the BNI and the military and everybody. I want to cross-check the facts. And it's coming out to say that some of the videos have been fake. To the extent that people want to play politics with it, it's unfortunate and it shouldn't be allowed to permit in these days. What we are facing is a national security threat, and people must understand it from that point. With regards to the SSEs, I believe that these are early days yet, and together they must review and be able to deal with the issues where they are SSEs. But so far, compliance has been good and it has been great, and we need to clap ourselves as citizens and as a military. Try to enforce the standard procedures for which the president has outlined.
I know that one of the discussions people have been having is whether or not our security agencies have the appropriate training. You and I know from your experience that in the past, security agencies have applied brute force in seeking to implement the law. And as transitions to democracy go on, there have been international best practices which suggest that security officers should be softening down. Do you think that we're lacking behind in the kind of training we issue our security forces in ensuring that they present a more humane and democratic face outside there in the conduct of their duties?
Definitely, definitely. Security infrastructure has been a problem, and it's a wake-up call that as we go forward, this country should not just be built by politicians. And it should not be politics of the day. We need to train our people. We need to apply ourselves to the best practices in the world. We need to be professional and we need to be diligent in dealing with different situations as they may appear. The role played within the security agencies would need to be improved again. And then again, training is a major thing. Once you don't train, you don't get the results. Some of these SSEs could be accrued to the fact that some people might be happy-go-lucky people, but on the whole, I think they should be prepared themselves and to be able to do a good job for this country because everybody is looking at them and they cannot fail.
Right. You have made mention of the fact that in your assessment, you get the sense that overall there being good compliance. But I mean, if we look at how some people have been recalcitrant and have stepped out there, when I spoke to the police hierarchy, they told me that there are people who just felt like getting out, just felt like walking about for absolutely no purpose. Does that worry you, especially considering that perhaps many of these people don't have sufficient information about exactly what is happening and why they're being asked to stay home?
Definitely, because education is lacking. there's confusion, even from the point of some of our security agencies. Orientation has been a problem. Everybody is speaking, so people are confused. And once you confine them and there's lack of information or the many confused statements coming from every quarter, it's good to ask people to move out. That is why I'm pleading with the security agencies. They should be consultants. They should listen to the people and let the speed principles be applied without being brutal by applying excessive force. It's going to be some of this confusion. People are new to it, and definitely they want to come out to the streets. Once people also don't have food in their home and they don't have money, it is a time for we to be one another's keeper. And let's speak to our people, educate them as much as possible, and we'll be able to apply ourselves to the standard principles of state of emergency.
Right. Finally, before you go, I heard you mention that this is a national security threat. We all know that it's a public health crisis, but tell me why, in your view, you think that this should be elevated to the status of a national security crisis?
It's a national security crisis because when you look at the components that come to the state of emergency or the powers invested in the president to declare the restriction he has imposed, that you're going to have economic issues, you are going to have social issues, your economy is locked down, people don't move, not moving. And then again, when much of the disease has been spread on the horizontal level, much of your workforce are going to die. The security agencies in the streets are not above, or they are not immune against the disease. And so therefore, you must attract it as a security agency issue. Then again, some saboteurs or aggressors could take opportunity to hit you down and crumble your country. These are the levels we are looking at it. Besides the healthcare issues, there are various components that cause for national worry, and national security approaches and strategies must be applied in this particular case to address it from all angles.
All right, Mr. Kumado, we're grateful for your time. Thank you extremely. My friend Richard Kumado is a fraud and security consultant. And I must say, big ups and kudos to all the security men and women out there who are seeking to enforce this public order and help us all deal with this crisis of coronavirus.